This is The Future Of, where experts share their vision of the future and how their work is helping shape it for the better.
I'm Jessica Morrison. One in six people worldwide suffer from hearing loss, yet it's one of the most preventable impairments. Current treatment for hearing loss is managed with hearing aids, cochlear implants, or surgery. In this episode, I spoke with Dr. Hani Al-Salami, an associate professor in the Curtin Medical School and Curtin Health Innovation Research Institute. He is also the head of Hearing Therapeutics Department at the Ear Science Institute Australia. Dr. Al-Salami and I talked about his novel treatment of hearing loss with medication, some of the causes of our collective deafness, and what we can do to protect our hearing. If you'd like to find out more about this research, visit the links provided in the show notes. This episode was recorded remotely due to COVID. So, Hani, we'll just dive right into the first question. How do we hear, and why are more of us experiencing hearing loss?
Okay, so to encapsulate the full picture, the hearing organ, you have three parts. There's the outer ear, there's the middle ear, and then there's the inner ear. The outer ear collects noise and passes them in through the middle ear, where we have parts of the ear that vibrates in a certain way that resonates with the sound and the intensity of it and the type of it, and it translates all that into the middle ear, into the inner ear. Inside the inner ear, we have cells. These cells vibrate as well, and they send the signal through nerves inside the inner ear all the way to the brain. So the inner ear is the part of the ear that can transfer sound into the brain.
And why are more of us experiencing hearing loss?
Okay, so it's a multifactorial question. So there's different reasons for that. First of all, age-related hearing loss is one of the main ones. And the second one, which is seen quite rapidly increasing the prevalence of hearing loss, is all this gadgets and music, things that we put in our ears that magnifies the noise, and the long-term use of them is anticipated to exacerbate hearing loss dramatically.
So what are the current treatments for hearing loss, and what are some of their limitations?
Well, there's no current drug for treating hearing at all indicated in the clinic. There are things that some people try, but the main two interventions for hearing loss is cochlear implants and hearing devices, or aids. They're the only two things that we have at the moment. They do help, and they're better than not having anything, but they've got great limitations. Not everyone can have them. In fact, one in five only in Australia use the hearing devices. In terms of the implants, it's a very, very invasive surgery. It is helpful, but it is invasive. And we also seen long-term complications when these implanted devices don't function well long-term, because the body can react to them, and those who their bodies react to these devices or implants can reduce the ability of these devices to function. And taking them out and putting another one in is not something we do. And we don't have a drug that can treat or cure hearing loss. That's what got me into this area in the first place. It's a very complex area where you need not just a pharmacist or a doctor, like myself, for example, but you also need the cochlear physiologist. I've got Daniel Brown, who I work very closely with. We've got surgeons, we've got other people, got chemists. So we have a very good group of people that I work with to overcome such obstacles, hoping to develop something that would make a difference.
Talking about developing something that's making a difference, or hopes to make a difference, as part of your Curtin research, you co-created a new formula of an existing drug that can be delivered directly into the inner ear to counter hearing loss. Can you tell me a bit more about this medication?
So one of the things that I've been pretty much working on all my life is the applications of some of our hormones that we produce in the body, in the gut, and repurposing these hormones to enable better and more optimum and safe drug delivery. For example, one of the areas that I worked on is adding these kind of digestive hormones or enzymes into a capsule that you can swallow, and it will take the drug more into the brain, and it worked. And I've taken this idea of an enzyme that the bile has got in it that produces to digest the food, into mixing it with a special gel using our technology, and that worked. So by doing it this way, the gel glues into the inner ear, and it facilitates the permeation and enhances the permeation of this drug, which is one of the most powerful antioxidants, all the way into inside the cochlea, what we call the inner ear.
So this is the first time anything like this has been developed or got to the point of development where it could potentially be a treatment for hearing loss?
That's correct. I just have to say that this is just not my work. It's a great group of people that I work with that I've been very lucky to have.
Who are some of the other people, or what are some of the roles that they're playing as part of the team?
So I am a pharmacist by trade. So I come from a pharmaceutical science background. So we have another pharmacist of mine, and that's I work very closely with, Armin Moranian. I've got also Daniel Brown, who is the physiologist, who understands the physiology of inside the inner ear. And we also have ENT surgeons like Jeffrey and Marcus. There's a group of people that we work with, and we also have chemists that have got a very good understanding of the chemistry of the nano-gel itself. So we all come from a different background, but it's really nice mix of expertise that made that happen.
Absolutely. What are some of the simple things we can do to prevent hearing loss? You mentioned that it can be age factors, but also things that we're doing in our lifestyle as well.
Yes, so overall, healthy living is a good thing. Second of all, of course you cannot help aging because we all will age at some point. But noise is a major contributor, more than 30%. And not only that, as you would imagine, a younger person now going for a run or having these gadgets inside their ears and blasting noise every day, a couple of hours a day, it will complicate things when they get older. So you're not going to just have someone who's aging nicely but just losing a bit of hearing. You're going to have someone who's already has got significant damage before they even start properly aging, if you know what I mean. And problem with that is that you can't reverse it back. And this is one of the greatest challenges. So for example, birds, you can regrow your hearing. They don't lose their hearing. But in humans, the cells, once they die, they don't go back. There are work that we're doing at the moment at eScience, which is gene therapy-based research. And that gene therapy aims at regenerating hair cells, or these hair cells that die because of, and as a result, we lose hearing. So noise is a major factor, in my opinion.
Does it look a little bleak in terms of suspected cases of hearing loss? Have we seen what will happen when we've had obviously lots more devices, earphones, AirPods, the like, grown in popularity in the last couple of decades? So have we really seen what the actual true effects of that is going to be? You mentioned obviously these people, that their hearing has already been sort of impacted before they've even hit older age. Do we expect the future of hearing loss to really be quite significant?
In my opinion, looking at it now, I think we're going to have a massive surge of hearing loss as we go, because we're growing older and we're also using more and more technology. And these two are the main drivers of exactly what's known as hearing loss. In terms of medications, we're not matching it with new drugs and new development. We don't have anything at the moment. There's no intervention that is in the clinic shown significance in terms of recovering hearing loss or even preventing it in the first place. So it doesn't look ideal, the situation, and we know for a fact that it is getting to, I mean, some expectations in WA, for example, in 1 in 2 in 2050 we'll have hearing loss problems. So it is growing rapidly, but ideally if a new drug comes to the market, then that should change things a fair bit.
That's good to know, considering that cases are expected to rise. Hani, you touched on this a little earlier. What inspired you to become a researcher in the area of pharmaceutical science, and why hearing loss specifically?
So pharmaceutical science is an area to me that I cannot get enough of. It excites me, it's intriguing, it combines biology, physics, chemistry. So it's a multifactorial type of research or studies that you can learn a lot from. You also can deal with patients directly, which I like to be a clinician. At the same time, you can develop new things that can help millions of people. All these combinations made me go for it.
You're head of hearing therapeutics department at the Ear Science Institute Australia. Can you tell me a little bit about some of the work you're doing in this role?
Okay, so it's a bit of a management role. I'm leading the department. We do have senior researchers that have got specific line of research inquiries that my role is to grow their profile, support the institute. We're growing the research capacity at eScience and driving engagement with Curtin to come up with something novel, robust, new and unique.
Well, definitely sounds like you're on the right path with what we've talked about a little earlier in this episode. What challenges have you faced in this area of research?
Well, as you could imagine, no one in the world so far has come up with the drug to treat hearing loss, which is an indication of how challenging this area is in terms of development. I mean, we normally have drugs treating a lot of things, cancer, diabetes, you know, all these things. You will have something, it may not cure it, but it's still at least it's indicated for significantly reducing the symptoms or side effects of other medication and things like that. Well, with hearing loss, there's nothing. So besides the implants and the hearing aids, that's about it. So there are other medications that people are trialing, but so far nothing is being clinically indicated. So the challenges, I would say, if you say one thing, is delivery. Is how can you manage to design something that will take your drug or your intervention or your gene all the way deep into the cochlear inner ear, which is a very tiny piece of bone stuck inside more bones. So as you can imagine, it's really challenging to go there, and that remains a major challenge.
How can people or industry get involved in your research?
Well, we already have people involved in terms of either patients interested in supporting us, engaging with us. Definitely the Telethon grant that I've received this year, funding this project, is part of it. Milestones is engagement with consumers. So that's one approach. We get emails from people interested in giving us their ideas and opinions and what journey have they gone through. It's very beneficial for us to understand it from a patient's point of view. Industry partners, if they're interested in investing and exploring options and opportunities with Curtin, that would be also great. So just direct engagement is always very useful for us.
We'll make sure we put all of your contact details in the podcast episode show notes as well. Just lastly, Hani, I mean, I don't know if you're prepared to say it, but if you could put a number on it, how many years off, hopefully, are we to having a targeted medication to treat hearing loss?
It's one question I get asked about very often, and it's one of these tricky ones that I always like to think about it as COVID vaccine. So normally medications from discovery, from zero to 100, it will take about 15 years on average. With COVID, it took a few months. So the question is really, how many people are interested to invest in curing hearing? And for that reason, it's quite hard for me to know, because I don't know what kind of funding available in the coming 5 years. There's a lot of unknowns, so it remains still a tricky question to answer. Sorry.
No need to apologize. I think really insightful answer there that you've given us. Thank you so much, Hani, for coming and discussing this topic today. It sounds like you've got some really exciting work that you're undertaking, and we look forward to hearing how it progresses.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
You've been listening to The Future Of, a podcast powered by Curtin University. If you've enjoyed this episode, please share it. And if you want to hear from more experts, stay up to date by subscribing to us on your favourite podcast app. Bye for now.